are back. I'm very happy to have on the Goldstein on Geld show Professor Colin Fullenkamp. He's at Duke University, and he is also one of the fabulous teachers from the Great Courses. And Colin has told me that his expert is in investing, and at the end of today's discussion, he's going to tell us his number one idea about investments that you need to hear in order to get on the road to financial success. So, Colin, very happy to have you.
Nice to be on the show, Doug. Thanks for inviting me.
One of the problems that I deal with a lot in with clients, you know, my day job is that I'm a financial advisor, is helping to take what seems like a very complicated world of investing and talk about it in human terms. How do you do that? What would you tell someone, let's say, who's just starting out in the world of investing?
Well, I think that's a great question, because it really can be intimidating to get started investing. I like to look at it from the standpoint that the complexity really means that there are tons of choices. And the way to think about it in my mind is to say, look, there's something out there for everyone, no matter what time of life you're in, or what you have to invest, or what your preferences are. If you put some effort into asking some questions and learning a little bit, you'll definitely find something that's right for you.
Okay, so you're saying that there's different strokes for different folks.
Yeah, absolutely. And it's really a matter of being persistent and asking a few questions until you find the thing that really is right for you, or the things, because I'm sure that there are many, many investments once you figure some things out about yourself and what your goals are that will be really appropriate for you and you'll be happy with.
Okay, so I like what you're pointing out about goals, because I talk about it all the time, and a lot of times, you know, people will come to my office and wonder, until I explain to them, you know, why is he asking me about my family and my kids, and,
exactly,
and where I live and my house, you know, just tell me what to do with my money.
Right.
But everyone's situation is different. How would you suggest that someone begin to formulate his own goals?
Well, I think the obvious goals, of course, are the big life goals, you know, saving for retirement, of course, or thinking, you know, if you want to start your own business someday, that's something you want to save for, sending your kids to school, college, or what have you. Those are the types of things you've got to sit down and think about first, about what you want to do. What are the big life goals that are going to take some money to achieve? And then once you do that, I think you really need to ask yourself a couple of questions. One is, how much time do you really want to put into managing your investments? It's possible to do very well and not put in a ton of time, but it's going to affect the investments that are right for you. There are some people who once they get into it really love it and are willing to put in, you know, hours a week to just looking at different types of investments and managing what they do. And that's all well and good. Both types of people can do really well. The second question is really seriously asking yourself what kind of risk you can really tolerate. You need to think, if I buy an investment and the next day the price drops 10%, how am I going to react? Am I going to take it well, or is it just going to bother me and I can't let it go? I think getting to understand your own personal risk tolerance is really, really important here. And those are the types of things that I like to talk about when I talk to people about investing.
Yeah, I think that's a very important point. One of the great quotes that they talk about Warren Buffett is they say, you know, how long do you hold on to investment? What's your investment horizon? And he says, forever.
That's
right.
It's
funny. He said, you know, imagine if you bought something and they just shut the stock market down for 10 years, what would happen? You know, not looking at it on a day-to-day basis, but of course some people just can't keep their eyes off the market.
Yeah, absolutely. And I think as a type of investor who's more like Buffett, I tend to invest the money and then try my best to just forget about it and let it work for me. I can certainly understand how some people can get really caught up in the day-to-day market movements and it causes them all kinds of headache. And that's definitely not what you want to get into as an investor.
So how would you help someone to differentiate between short-term issues and long-term fundamental changes? You know, whether it's the government shutting down or the real estate implosion or the high-tech bubble, and long-term investors, you know, guys obviously like you and me, when we tell people, be a long-term investor, it seems to have always worked out well. But isn't there a time, or isn't there something that you want to tell people to look out for, that really it's a new paradigm now, that now we have to change?
I think that there are big changes in the economy happening all the time. I mean, we're in this huge shift towards, you know, even beyond kind of the knowledge-based economy to the social networking economy. So those are really big shifts. But I think what's surprising to me, and I think surprising to a lot of people, is how the fundamentals of investing still don't change. You're still looking for good long-term performing companies that are making products and services that people want. I mean, if you're playing the stock market or you're looking for a solid opportunity. So I guess from my perspective, the things that are really driving the long-term progress of the economy and off of which all of our financial investments are based really aren't changing that dramatically, I guess. So I'm really long-term optimistic, and I think as long as you can ride out a lot of the short-term day-to-day fluctuations, I think you'll do really well as an investor.
Okay, we're talking with Connell Fullenkamp, who's a professor at Duke University in the Department of Economics. He also teaches with the Great Courses. And hang on in just a few minutes. At the end of the interview, he's going to talk to us about his number one tip to get you on the road to financial success. But we've been talking about dealing with risk and tolerance for risk. Now, you've done a lot of research about the management of risk. What do you advise investors, normal people, not you know, the institutions, what do you advise them about how to manage financial risk?
Well, that's an excellent question. In fact, I'm actually teaching a course this semester at Duke on risk management, and it's a lot of fun. But when it comes down to personal investing, the first step is really to identify what risks are the big risks that you need to worry about. In my mind, for an individual investor, there are really two big risks. One of the risks, of course, is what we call market risk, just the risk that the prices of your investments will fall rather than going up. And fortunately, market risk management is a matter of time for the individual investor. You can manage your market risk through choosing investments carefully, again, according to your risk tolerance, but also by giving enough time to your investments to actually work themselves out. It turns out that time is a really great ally, and when markets go down, they usually come back up again. In fact, they come back up again sometimes surprisingly soon. So that's one great strategy for that type of risk. The second type of risk, which I think is actually more dangerous that people tend to underestimate, is inflation risk. To me, that is by far the biggest worry for the individual investor. And that's different from market risk because it's not the risk that your investments don't do well, but it's the risk that the prices of everything that you're saving for goes up. And that's something that we really can't deal with all that well. The best defense I can think of is to use specific financial instruments that are designed to deal with inflation. And the one that comes to mind are inflation indexed bonds. So these are bonds that you buy in which either the interest rate or the price of the bond goes up automatically with inflation. And it's still an imperfect way to deal with inflation risk, but it seems to be the best we can do.
Okay, that's a very complete answer. I was thinking, what are other tools that people use for risk management? Of course, there's always prayer, but...
Yeah, that's right. but I think, you know, there's a big distinction between what individuals can and should do about managing risks and what professionals do. And it's not that the professional tools are necessarily dangerous or too complicated. It's that they're just expensive. They're too expensive for an individual investor to use.
That's a great point. A lot of people feel, well, I'll just trade in options or hedge in certain situations, and they don't realize, well, you know, doing it on a one-time basis might be fine, but to maintain a long-term portfolio that way, it's very expensive insurance.
Yeah, exactly. I think your point is exactly right. You have to think about it like buying insurance, and most of us know that when we buy, you know, car insurance or health insurance, that insurance is expensive. And you have to think about that in terms of risk management in your portfolio. My suggestions, when I try to think about individual risk management, I'm out there looking for the cheapest possible ways to manage risk. And one of the cheapest possible things you can do, of course, is diversify your portfolio. And diversification is basically free.
Mm-hmm. Of course, when the market crashed, let's say in 2007, 2008, everything went down.
Yeah, that's right. And there's certainly times when that'll happen. And then you have to fall back on this idea of using time as your ally. And I realize that not every investor has time on their side, but if you can possibly swing it, you need to use time as your as you need to get time on your side to give your investments the time that they need to come back if they should fall in value.
Yeah, you know, one of the ways that I usually like to describe it is when people talk about risk, I tell them you have to differentiate between risk and volatility. To me, as a financial planner, the risk that I'm the most worried about for my clients is the risk that they will run out of money during their lifetime.
Yes, absolutely.
I can't have some old lady coming to me, you know, saying, hey, you did this financial plan 25 years ago and now I'm broke, right? That's the risk. Volatility is the ups and downs in the market, which, you know, you have to educate clients about, but that's, you know, if you can't stand it, then what do they say? If you can't stand the heat, get out of the oven, then you can't be.
Yeah, that's true. I think a lot of us have to get over that hump and realize that volatility is just a normal part of the game. Part of the reason why the financial markets are developed is because there are opportunities for people to take both sides of trades, and to have that, you need some volatility. So it's a necessary ingredient of having good financial markets, but it does put a lot of people off.
Connor, we are nearly out of time, which I'm sorry about, because I have a whole string of other questions I'd like to talk to you. But I also want to get back to our original promise to the listeners that I was going to ask you, what is the number one thing you think people need to know about now in order to get on the road to financial success?
Well, I think the number one thing is something I always tell people when they get into investing, which is to do your homework. And that means asking lots of questions and not settling for answers that you don't understand. I think that investing is fundamentally an easy thing to do, but you have to get out there and ask questions and be satisfied that you know what you're getting yourself into. If you can raise your comfort level with investing and understand the things that you're getting into, then you can be a very successful investor, no matter how much or how little you put in and how much or how little time you put into it. That's my best investing advice.
I think it's fabulous advice. A lot of times people ask me, how should I decide which financial advisor to work with? And I tell them, find someone who spends the time to teach you about what you're doing and doesn't just say, give it to me, I'll take care of everything for you.
Absolutely.
I think it's real important. Okay, we have been talking with Connell Fullenkamp, a professor at Duke University. Connell, in the last few seconds, just tell us, how can people follow you and follow your work?
Well, you can find me through the great courses. I have the Understanding Investments course, and I also have a new one on financial literacy coming out.
Okay, so we will look forward to that. We'll put a link to that at the show notes at goldsteinongelt.com.
Thanks so much.
Thank you.
You've been listening to the Goldstein on Gelt show with money maven Doug Goldstein. Doug's weekly radio show is heard around the world, but if you miss it, you can download the podcast at www.goldsteinongelt.com. The Goldstein on Gelt show gives you up-to-date financial ideas so you can get on the path to financial freedom. If you'd like your questions answered on the air or off, send Doug an email to doug@profile-financial.com. It's your money for your future, so join Doug every week to build your wealth on the Goldstein on Gelt show.